England with an organization called CCAT. It's a poisoning community against trafficking. This one is different. It's called Safer Media, and it is actually developed by two ladies who really felt passionate about the role the media plays in bringing across pornography. And you cannot imagine the extent that this goes out. And I would like to read this, but please listen and then tell me what you think. I would like to introduce the work by the UK charity called Safer Media, which is co-founded by two ladies called Miranda Stewart and Kipper Smith. Can you hear it? So, the facts and figures that I'm presenting you here is an actual research and data collected by concerned individuals and organizations. Safer Media deals with one of the most important educators of children in the developed world. This educator is influencing every aspect of our children's lives, to some degree whether they or their parents are aware or not, whether they accept it or not. It affects their lives, their dislikes, their self-image, how they pass their time, how they spend their money, and most concerning, how they relate to their families and to each other. And CDs, video games, YouTube, and their social life on mobile phones, Facebook, chat rooms, and Twitter. The online world of the internet has become the most important media environment for our children and young people. And it is indeed, on one hand, a wonderful resource, opening up a new whole world of knowledge and creativity. However, and this is a big however, the online world can also be very dangerous place. Very dangerous either because of other users or due to the violence, bad language, sex, and other harmful websites that are so easily to find on the internet. The internet saturates our children's world, and for our purposes today, it becomes crucial to assess just what they are learning from the media about sex, how men and women are portrayed, how they relate to each other, and what can boys and girls learn about these things. And sadly, it's often the information that a lot of information which is unavoidable about pornography. Actually, pornography has driven the growth of the internet, and one in five searches online are for porn. What is pornography, you will ask? Pornography is defined as material that depicts erotic behavior and whose sole intention is to cause sexual excitement. There are other slightly different definitions. It can be soft or hardcore. Research and our collective experience show that pornography is taking a real toll on the mental, emotional, and physical health of our young people and poses a serious challenge to public health in the UK. It is very far from being the harmless and victimless activity portrayed by the increasingly powerful pornography industry. This is how the effect of porn has on adolescence is summarized by Dr. Bill Struthers. He's an associate professor of psychology in a college in America. I think I'll leave this out. You can.
People that speak the same language. So, one more time. The colored sticker on the side of the chair indicates the group. Just know that the same colored sticker will work in the same group. Any questions? But we will start with a little warm-up exercise in your group. Later, Marcella and I will tell more about our project. The first is our teaching, when I teach the very tough lesson for one, and I repeat it from from psychologist Irina Freyhoff. And since I don't have my PowerPoint presentation, I have to describe it to you, yeah? It's a picture of moms
holding a child. And the child says, love me, even though I'm strange and dirty and not enough. Because if I was perfect, everybody would love me. And this is the unconditional love. This is the mother love. This is something which is really very much our capability as a woman and mother, and this is what we need to bring to society as well. And for me, it's a big issue for a long time already, acceptance. I had a private talk with God himself about acceptance. And I think we try to accept our spouse, we try to accept our children, we try to accept the situation. But also, at least for me it is, and if you find yourself in it as good, we should accept ourselves as well. As we are, yeah, in this moment. Because principle is teaching us periods of growth, yeah, and even the father has to prepare for his mission. Jesus has to prepare for his mission, and sometimes we are impatient with ourselves. So I keep on like to tell you, and this is how I did mentioning, but maybe I should keep to them. thank you. But it's very much connected, because if we don't start with ourselves, if we don't accept our moment situation,
we can potentially want each deal actually to stop the different area, and it's the same area that Janas is working, because I work with social aid committee.
Social AIDS Committee. It's HIV AIDS issues and also drug addiction and etc. So we do a lot of educational projects in Central Eastern Europe, also in former Soviet Union countries. But these are very specific projects, very often for medical professionals, for psychiatrists, psychologists. But as an NGO, so the mechanism for writing a project application or for getting money for the project are very similar. So I want to share my experience so that Women's Federation chapters can also use my experience. And I have experience with different donors, we call them, and I think the biggest project that I coordinated was just finished, and that was the coordinator for the European project implemented in some countries. It's called Mental Health and HIV. And it was all funded by the European Commission. Actually, the European Commission has different directorates, and each is responsible for certain fields. And as HIV/AIDS organization, I work with the DigiSanCom, which is Directorate for Health. Yeah, and we are supported by executive agents for health and consumer. But also there are other directorates, like for example for you, and also for other issues that you can apply. But I will get to those later. And I also would like to, based on my experience, and also Marcella will make some comments based on her experience, we will show you actually some of the conclusions that we came to after a common discussion. So, we all know that in Women's Federation we have a lot of know-how, very interesting ideas, very interesting vision. But the reality is, and I don't know if it came up in your discussions, but it came up in our discussion with Marcella, we all are worked out, over them, very often we volunteer our free time without any money. That's like in my case, I have 5 kids, a professional job, and volunteering for Women's Federation. And I think many of them can relate. And my kids are 15, 25, and 15. I know many other ladies in the room actually that have similar situations. Or have written. How do we do it? How do we do it more successfully? Actually, I think the solution is to get additional funding for our project.
They should develop ideas for projects, prepare a project application, and apply for money. Because if they have money, then actually we can hire an assistant, we can hire a professional accountant, we can hire experts, and those people will do what they are good at, which is administration, accounting, and then we are free actually to make lectures, to actually implement our ideas, etc., etc.
Maybe for
from the practical viewpoint, it's good first to have people in your mind who already know how to do it, because if you apply the grant, you receive the money, and afterwards you are desperately searching for someone who starts to learn this. You are just wasting the time, so it's good to already have somebody, and in case you receive the grant, the money, so you can pay him.
Yes, absolutely. That's very, very important, because you really have to choose your people that you work with very carefully. And we even put the word witness yourself. It means that as we are an NGO, it's very helpful if you get people that have vision and share your vision. And also people that are excited about what you're going to do. But also, of course, you should know how to empower people and motivate them. But we know it because we have children and we have to motivate them all day long. Yeah? It's the same through words, yeah? Stick them together. But if you have really good people, then this is how 90% of the success of the project, I tell you. Like, when I started this European project, I have one assistant that I hired just because somebody recommended the girl. She was a very nice girl, but finally, actually, she didn't make it. We were late with the project, and there was a second assistant who turned to be even worse, and I was making all the job for him instead of doing my own responsibility. And then finally, at the third attempt, I got a very great assistant who is actually so capable, she's capable of doing everything by herself. I'm thinking maybe in the future she can focus on the social activity and I'll focus more on the women's situation, yeah. But that's what Marcella said. It's much better to find such people in advance, not during the process.
One of the weak points of our motherly aspect, sometimes we care so much for people that we don't really have any demands, yeah. And I think myself realized this. I had a secretary and she had a difficult problem and so on, and I started to help her. I was obviously making coffee for her, yeah, and caring for her. And finally I was doing the job by myself and still helping her, yeah. So this is one of the points of our motherly love. So we had really to be also professional and demand, because as a parent, we also need to educate our children so that they can become responsible and not only care for them.
Also, I think in the session in the morning we talked about our strong points and our weak points. I think it's very important to focus on what we are good at and then find somebody else who can do what we are weak at. And then we talk about projects actually. It's very nice actually and helpful to work in partnerships with other organizations. And actually, my experience who work in NGO field demonstrated that there are organizations there in the field that are very happy to write the project for you and do all the administration work, but they do not have expert knowledge. So they will be happy to partner with you and write the project together with you, and then they will actually do all the bureaucracy stuff at the European Commission, for example, instead of you. Like in my case, all the ministers, no, European Commission people here, so I can say, I spent probably 85% to 90% of my working time on those administrative and bureaucratic issues, instead of coordinating and doing real creative work for the project. And that's a huge problem. But for example, in Italy, and not some of the second known organization, it's called EDES, and it's an NGO that actually specializes in writing applications for European Commission. For example, last year they had simultaneously 10 projects co-funded by the respective agency for health and consumers. And then they approach, they find an expert organization, for example, a university or an NGO, they write, the expert organization develops the concept, and they write, and they even write the application, and then they, because they know how the European Commission works, they actually implement the project and do all the reporting. So if you find such an organization to work with, that's huge.
And we can see, you don't come in that baby, don't you want to give me some money?
No.
And yes, really, we have a wonderful project to really help our children to grow in a responsible people to go lead society in a proper way. We are here, so would you like to make some partnerships? Can we do something together? Yeah. We should not also underestimate other people because they are experts in something. Yeah, but they can do everything, and we also are experts in something, and we also can do anything, yeah? This is what I'm doing, yeah? And I recommend you don't do it, yeah? Because we afterwards spend, as Alexandra said, 90% of our precious time by doing things which others can do much, much, much better and quicker, and we don't have free capacity in what we are experts in. So we can really come and we can really offer the partnership. And there may be some people who are a businessman or whatever, and they also have a family. They also want their children to live a safe world, yeah? And they will be grateful for if they can participate. Just invite them to be partners. It might be honor for them if they can really participate, and we can give our know-how, yeah? So we can be paid for it. We don't need all the time to suffer if I will have enough money to buy bread for my children and if I can allow them to play the piano and pay for it, yeah? Because we are doing really valuable work. So this is what I wanted to add, really. Don't, if you start to apply the grant, just search for publishing. Think about know-how we have and make a plan before, yeah? You have make first-class plans and have the valuable content and afterwards just as a magnet to attract those who are searching for the content and don't have it. But they have money. They don't want where to put them, yeah?
Yeah, but keep in mind, if you join some other organizations as an expert, you may not need to deal with administration issues, but later the organization won't have financial record, yeah, and when you apply yourself to grants, they always check your previous history when you have experience. So it has its advantages and disadvantages, of course. And one more thing I think is really important is that the project should be based on a real need. Not that we have to come up with an abstract idea, it would be great to plant some trees on the moon, yeah, something like that. But sometimes our project similar to this, maybe not that absurd, but anyway. So, we always have to identify how we call it in the project language, the target group, and talk to people from the group. Like, do you really need this? Like, talk, we want to do something for our children. Do you really want to have such a seminar in summer? Yeah, when you do this and that activity, will you come? Will you invite your friends to come? This is important. And I think also, when I look at NGOs, I think the most successful NGOs are the NGOs that unite people that are actually affected by certain problems or want to achieve certain goals. People that are personally motivated. So choose for your project the issues that are important for you, for your family, for your relatives, for your community, for your country. As a very short example, like obstacle projects that we sometimes have. We normally don't make it after this, but actually I tend to get some special things often. Yes. No, but sometimes actually, even in Poland, we did some obstacle projects, but they were more like a commander still, like a person I met. And actually, I met this person only during that obstacle, and nothing ever happened later. But recently, we had a very interesting experience in Poland, which really taught me a lot. Maybe for people from other regions who don't know, but Poland and Russia, actually my husband is Polish, I come from Russia, they come to any country. They've been like for centuries. And like a certain point, for example, Poland does not exist, and it was divided between three countries, Austria, Hungary, Prussia, Germany, and Russia. Actually, Poles now have made a mess with the Austrians, with the Germans, but they still hate Russia. Also because of the communist and that's one issue which is really very deep. This irrelevant cutting happens in the forest near the border between Belarus and Russia. And about 22,000 Polish officers and Polish nationals were killed by Soviet secret services in 1940. And during Soviet times, the matter was cut out. Nobody ever spoke about it openly. So actually, Poles, they have huge resentment towards Russia and Russians about the cutting issue. Yeah? And actually, Russians, we are not aware. When they came to Poland, they have got to know about cutting. In Russia, they know about cutting, which is a totally different thing. And it was just a small village where people were massacred by Germans, but it was like about 100 people during the Second World War. I'm not saying it's Bucha, but I'm saying that it's different. Yeah? But the propaganda, so this propaganda shows cutting instead of cutting, so just to make up this, you think people care, so that people do not know what is cutting, what they're talking about. Anyway, so Russians are unaware, and secondly, because in Russia about 20 million people died as a result of the revolution and later the civil war, so actually 22,000 compared to 20 million. The whole country is covered with such mass problems, I would say. So these are two different perspectives. And we decided actually to let people know about this. So we decided to make a project when we bring together people from Poland affected by cutting, like children, grandchildren of people who were massacred in cutting, and also bring people from Russia. Actually, they came from Russia, not from the other side, but from North, actually. And we said we want to educate people to know about cutting, and we want actually to say the story. We really want to say the story. And we have some small sisterhood, actually. When it was just the first step, yeah, when we had about 40 people in the room, and actually it was so deep, there were so many tears, so many emotions, I would never expected that. And people came up to me later and said, the thing you did, you were so honest, people that were so sincere, it really moved our hearts. Some people said, I could not forgive, I could not have the Russian, that is too much. But that was the simple, yeah? So I think if you really have to look at that song. So I'm not trying to be short now. Okay. Yeah, just do something when it's really important. Okay, now the more specific part. How do we look for money? And we have certain suggestions, people. Some certain funding opportunities that will be opening in December and next year. And actually, those two suggestions concern specific countries, not all of the countries in the States, but we also have some suggestions for people from all over Europe. So just if your country is not mentioned, that your petition is made for the next slide. Of course, there are different sources of funding, and probably if you have time to talk for us, don't you need. You can discuss all different types, but because we come from the Central European and Eastern European region, we don't have private sponsors there. So our expertise is only with applying for grants. That's why we're discussing this issue with my colleagues. And of course, when you work in your country, there are also national donors, like municipalities. In Poland, actually, they basically go to municipalities, they have the biggest money. Some national foundations, ministries. There are some regional donors. Maybe you know some of them, maybe don't. I'll mention them actually, all of them more in detail. And some international donors. Well, and now a few specifics. Nordic Council of Ministers, programs, countries, or NGOs in the Baltic Sea region. So who is eligible? Actually, Nordic countries. If there are any in the room, also people from one of the countries, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, or Poland, and you should have a partner from Russia or Belarus. but you can get about 50,000 euros. You can apply 1 year, and then you can actually extend it for a second year. They most often say yes. And actually, third one, point, you need an official auditor at the end of the project, but you have to, of course, in the budget, to see some money for the auditor, financial auditor. This is doable. So, and their priorities for funding, they're very broad. So basically, anything regarding cooperation between NGOs of those countries is possible. So like, there are a lot of opportunities in that. There's also a possibility for so-called Visegrad countries, which is Czech, Hungary, Poland, and Slovakia. And well, if you're one of these four countries, you can apply, actually, for very small grants. It's up to 6,000 euros, but at least three countries out of those four should be involved. And actually, also, money can be used almost for anything, because you can see priorities, it's everything. Sports, youth, cultural cooperation, growth, etc. And I have a few deadlines during the year, actually four, so basically you can apply any time. And of course, full funding is 30%, but it can be in-kind contributions, so you're going to see your work or your office space, or when people come from other countries, they stay in the flat of people and not in the hotel. All this is included. So this is a great idea for short projects. They also have bigger projects for Visegrad countries plus Eastern Partnership countries. And if you work with them, Eastern Partnership countries are actually Belarus, Ukraine, Moldova, Georgia, Azerbaijan, not Russia. Well, and these are also quite interesting funding opportunities. Now they have an opportunity for Visegrad countries to work in, but not Balkan countries, for example, with Albania, Macedonia,
Scandinavia, and not also in many countries in Western Europe. And
okay.
We apply to the UN for some funding, so we have to do it.
Apply for funds, and then I got some answers, and unlucky I got rejected, and I was very disappointed. But then I just think, okay, at the end of April, I think they had another call, okay, in the beginning of June. I checked it really late, and I was not very hopeful. And I said, okay, I just put it together, and I sent it to them. But I had no time, and I just sent to Hungary, because they wanted another document, so. And this one, I got the project, so really, I want to apologize to those who wanted to cooperate with me, because in the second round, I didn't, when they talked to everybody, but I'll try again. So, I'll just say shortly, the Youth in Action is a program that relates to the project with young people in education in different areas. So, usually it relates to the police change between the countries, and I think it's a big opportunity to use to anything for youth, especially that they also have good cooperation between the countries, we can prove it. They want to see that they have a cooperation, reliable. So my they're quite fair in the project, because I say, no, they have this tribal mentality. And even the foreign agencies, they just work with the people they know, it's very hard to break through. But I feel these people are quite sick. They have a good idea, it's well written, they will agree. But on the other hand, they are very bureaucratic. So basically what you need to do is go online, just Google this Youth in Action, and they have a program guide. So the program guide is around 100 pages long. So it just takes such a terribly long time. You have to study their precisely, look at all the details, all the points, what they want, what's the data. So this just takes very long time, and you have to fill out the application form. So that's why, first time I got rejected, this was a few stupid details. That's why I kind of gave up on them. So, yeah, that's take up the point. But I think there is a possibility they have a lot of money. And I think the next call is the final day is 1st of February. And I think something from somebody like they are finishing some part of their, like, I don't know, funds that is allocated. And there's a big chance for winning the project if you're trying. So, for this important, you have to be legal in your country.
And actually, it's all explained by an assistant. So, you know how to improve for the future if you actually were not accepted for the first time. Actually, any European country can apply, of course, EU country, and also not EU member European countries can also apply. And also, like, you can make partnerships with non-EU countries in Europe, so, like, everybody programs. That's a lot of jobs. And this is for those who do not have any financial record, financial history. And that's one of the startup activity. For example, I found the Global Fund for Women. That actually gives small money, that is good for the staff, yeah, and also for a very actually broad range of thematic areas. So you can choose. Actually, as the presentation will be available on the internet, so you can get the site, yeah, and you can check the information on the internet. So I was thinking now, maybe you could also ask people in the room, what is your experience? What funds can you recommend for some countries that haven't been mentioned, like for the UK, for example?
Yeah, some proposal, but it's a little bit, it does not fit exactly to what we are doing, but it fits a little bit, so maybe we can do it because we can receive the money somewhere. And we, one by one, we can be defined from our original vision. So please be careful and don't compromise with your vision and with what you really want to because of money. It can be a sense. Yeah, so please be aware that really you have the vision and don't. Yeah, I am doing this, but they don't need money for this, but they need money for this. So maybe I can do this, I should receive the money, and yeah, we have to, it does not mean we should just do, we can do something, if it brings money and which we can use for our activity, it's still good. But we have to do it being aware, yeah, really to put what will bring what and for which price. This was just one point, and now it's a time.